Good morning. కృష్ణమూర్తి గారు, జగదీశన్, హాయ్ సుభాష్, గుడ్ మార్నింగ్, కలయ్ వణక్కం, హాయ్ ధీరాజ్, హాయ్ శ్రీధర్ బాబు, హాయ్ సత్యారెడ్డి రావు గారు, కేజీకే గారు నమస్తే, గుడ్ మార్నింగ్, వెల్కమ్ టు యూ, హాయ్ ప్రదీప్, welcome to you all. Yeah, you are teaching me Tamil script also, Subhash. Hi Madhavi, good morning. Rohit, Santosh Kumar, Hemant Reddy garu, Bhujang Rao, good morning. Hi Maul Rao garu. Hi Anup, good morning to you. Hi Gaurinath. Good morning and welcome to you all. Jahir Hussain, Hari Prasad, Hiremath, VN Hiremath, Satish Bhatt, good morning. Hi Lakshmi, good morning to you. Sambhaji Dhananjay, Anand Sardesai, Ravinder Shekhar, good morning to you all. Ravindra Babu, Ravindra Kole, Subramaniam, Lavanya, good morning to you. Oh, so we have a rock excavation contractor in this lecture, so it's good. Devansh Kuchal, Mohammad Ishaq, Siddesh, Bharat Upaswami, Jubair Ali, Damodar, Subramaniam, hi, good morning. Lakshmi Narasimha, Kamal Gaur, Sunil Farkya, Tarak Pradhan, Damodar, Avinash Naik, Ganesh Nimjay, Sai Krishna, Ratnaji, Praveen Kumar. We'll start in 2 minutes. Rachna Mahajan, Raju Jan, Shiva Shankar, good morning, Yogesh, yeah, good morning, Subramaniam. So lockdown is extended by another 2 weeks. Really challenging coping up with this long lockdown period. Madina, Rafiq, Kiran Aditya, Santosh Balaya, Mohammad Ishaq, thank you. Ajit Kumar, Kamishravar, namaste, welcome. Hi Chitti Babu, Damodar, Kamal Gaur. Yeah, Monday is my highway is over, no? Yes. Sheikh Ikram. Highway is available in YouTube now, you can see. Metla Srinivas Rao Garu, Tirunakkar Garu, Kiran Aditya, Raghavendra, Amit Rangire. Want to become like you, give advice and suggestions. Keep working, Srikant. Yeah, Ramji Iyengar. And keep interacting with me. I'll guide, no problem. Jagdish Keshwani, Govind Parchani, Narendra Reddy, Amit Barmane, Amalan, Rajesh Khanna. Welcome you all. So we are starting the topic today. Hi Deepi, good morning, welcome to you. So today's topic is again considered to be simple, but as far as I am concerned is a really challenging topic, that is earthwork, rocketing, earth filling, excavation and disposal. So, wavy of the topic today is introduction, and then earthwork, what is earthwork, what is excavation, filling, rock cutting and shoring and studding. So these are all very simple things as we consider, and engineers think that it is the job of the contractor doing the earthwork, but I beg to differ with that, because the method of excavation, the earthwork is a contractor's baby actually, because this is the first work, they want to earn money in the earthwork. So if we engineers are working for the project, working for the client, it is our responsibility to see that the specification, the methodology, the leads, lift, everything is optimized and the cost of earthwork is minimized, because it is the first cost to be spent by the client. There is a lot of ambiguity in earthwork specifications actually. I will share you as we move forward. So that is why engineers have to be more careful in giving the specification and schedule of items. And even earthwork requires proper drawing and planning and method statements. This is what I want to tell you. And so projects always or construction is preceded by excavation actually. So foundation is part of any of the construction project. So foundation requires excavation and backfilling. And construction site also, it will never be a level ground. So we have to change the levels of the site. So either by cutting or by filling. So we need earthwork in any project. And the basement excavation is one of the important things when we have parking below the ground. And filling and backfilling is whenever we do excavation, there will be a backfill. Or backfill, the use of the excavated earth may not be approved. So we have to use the borrowed earth for filling. And roads, particularly within the projects, industrial layouts also, we will be getting huge level differences. And sometimes clients want the road to be level. So we form the embankments. And so crust formation for the roads also, even otherwise, even if you have a level ground, we want to raise the road level from the natural ground. So we have to do the crush formation for the design loads. And the machinery required also will be earthwork, because this is a huge mass work always, where we need to deploy the machinery. So we need to understand which machinery is useful for which type of earthwork, whether it is cutting, filling or transporting is very important. So this is the topic today I am going to talk. So earthwork, before we talk about earthwork, we have to understand what are the underground utilities, chartered or uncharted. So uncharted, chartered means they are indicated by the client. Uncharted means we have to do the investigation to understand if there are any utilities running below the ground. So without knowing them, if we start the excavation, particularly with the machinery, it can cause damage to those utilities. So we'll have a power line above the ground, passing through the site. So we have to shift these power lines to match our design. Our design has to consider the power line and old structures demolition. Before planning, we have to have the permission sometimes to do the demolition also. Tree cutting, bush clearance, tree translocation, and top layer removal. These are all the activities prior to real earthwork we do. This is a prerequisite for the earthwork actually. So we have earthwork in excavation, earthwork in backfilling, earthwork in disposal. Sometimes we have a lot of excess work, particularly when we go for basements, we can't reuse all that excavated earth. So we have to either dispose it or we can use it in somewhere, or we can get the credit for the soil also. We have done certain projects, earthwork, where client earned money through earthwork. He didn't pay. So that also we have to consider the valuation of the type, depending on the type of the soil. And earthwork in filling, sometimes we have to raise the ground level, then we have to borrow the earth. So we have to raise the ground level. Then earthwork moving, that means within the site, we have to regrade the site. That means cut and fill balancing we'll be doing based on the levels. We have to cut to one place and fill at the other place. We had one project of 120 acres where client wanted to follow Vastu and the site is totally against the Vastu. That means southwest is at low level, northeast is at the high level. So we had to do the entire cutting of northeast side and fill it on the southwest side. Of course, as an engineer, I am not for it, but when the client feels it will only make the project successful, we have to support them. So we had to remove the earth. Fortunately, the quality of the soil was good, so we could fill it with that soil. So, and even, okay, this is Vastu, I said. In another project where Malaysians are the consultant, they wanted total plant area to be like a table level. Nowhere you will get a perfect level ground naturally. There will be natural contours in every site. So 10 feet, 3 meters is a common level variation in the sites ranging from 10 acres to 50 acres. So we had to do the entire cutting of the entire land of about 20 acres to make it level. So we have foreseen if we cut any natural ground, there will be flooding actually. Is it not? There will be a water coming, and if you are removing the natural slope, it will stay in your site. So we had to plan the stormwater drains even before we started the excavation. So this is the kind of thinking that is required in every project. Please don't treat earthwork as the simple activity. So we have to plan. Engineers only can plan it, I am telling. Otherwise, if we leave it to the contractors, if we leave it to the clients, the cost is going to be higher. In one project where we did about 1.8 million square feet, 14 floors, it was a lump sum design build contract, but the cost increase happened only in excavation. 3% cost increase, just in excavation. Because in spite of so much of care in specifying, due to the investigation, due to the RQD value difference, the rock type has changed from the soil investigation, because in soil investigation we do the borehole only. We recover the rocks and all that, but always it is challenging to understand the type of rock and method of cutting. That is why I'll spend some time on different methods of rock cutting also. So method of measurement is another important thing in the excavation, because we have to plan the drawings for excavation, giving required elements for shuttering or placing of the strut, shoring actually, if you are using wooden shoring and all that. So this method of measurement gives you 1.2 meters from the face of the footing you have to allow for excavation. So unless you give a specific method, specific payment for that method, you have to allow as per the code IS 1200, the method of measurement. So this is a very important aspect. So in excavation, next is the excavation. We have different types of excavation. We have a mass excavation, huge excavation running into lakhs of cubic meters of earth and footing excavation, that is local small areas like 3 meter by 3 meter by 3 meter. And we have trench excavation where we have the strip footings, or we have series of isolated footings, gap between them is less, then you will get a trench. And we also do trench excavation for the pipeline or underground cable works, electrical cables or communication cable, OFC. These are all the requirements we get. And deep excavation is another thing, as one type of excavation where we need shoring system to be adopted. And we have the basement excavations that is required, where we have to plan the drainage properly whenever we plan the basement for the building. Earth moving and disposal. Earth moving, sometimes within the site we will be storing the earth for reuse for backfilling. Otherwise, whatever excess earth is there, we have to dispose. And sometimes the leads, we had to have a big discussion on the lead of disposal. Because within the cities, when we are doing basement excavation, the lead can go up to 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers. And we are allowed to do excavation only in the night time. So that planning involves a lot of thinking and discussion with the contractor and client about this disposal, actually. And dewatering, drainage. Drainage is a very, very important thing when we plan the excavation, because sometimes the excavation itself will take 1 year in the project. So during that 1 year, we have to think of rainfall. We have to think of the drainage of the water collected in the pit to avoid pumping or to avoid the collapse of the earth. There will be huge water collected in the excavated pits, actually. And dewatering. When we do this excavation in the sites where water level is at a very high level, at a shallow depth from the ground, then we have to plan the dewatering system in the excavation itself. And then excavation phasing, that also we will discuss how to phase the you cannot think that entire 1 year you will be doing excavation and wait for completion of excavation and start construction after 1 year. No, we'll plan the phasing such that we'll start one phase of the building after completing half area up to full depth, and then plan the other half area. And the formation of ramps for vehicle movement for carrying the earth, and identifying the spoil tips for disposal of the excess surplus earth, and drawings for excavation. This is my thing I'll be covering today. And the filling, backfilling, filling with available earth, borrowed earth. For borrowed earth, we have to identify the borrow pits. We have to buy the land sometimes, or we have to lease the land for if there is an excess earth level. Formation of embankments. You know, in the railways and highways, whenever we form the embankment, we have to leave it for 6 months for it to settle naturally. So that's very important. Even in private projects, we have to follow that for settlement. That is the best thing. Pitching for embankments, that slopes formation, or reinforced earth retaining walls, and the use of geotextiles in embankments, formation of the higher level embankments. And the grading of the soil, ground level, coffer dams, that is in dams we get to use consumption of 10 lakh cubic meters or 3 million cubic meters of earth is required for formation of the coffer dam. We do ring bunds. You know, ring bunds in the river beds when we could do the bridge construction. So there also we need the earth filling for ring bunds. So, and for all the filling, wherever we have the loading after filling, we have to have the proper density test, and we have to plan the stages of filling also. So this is the about filling. And rock cutting, we have to discuss about methods of cutting. There are so many methods which will be, I'll be showing some of the videos also quickly, and because it is difficult to understand, I'll share those videos today. And mass excavation in rock cutting also, we had to do 1 lakh cubic meters of rock cutting in a city, and it took 1 year. And drilling, for drilling holes into the rock, either for micropiles or for putting the expansive chemicals. So drilling methods also we should know. Investigation for RQD, rock quality designation, and planning to avoid rock cutting. Now, we had done one project like Dell in Hi-Tech City in Hyderabad about 15 years back, 16 years back. So which we had to plan to complete in 6 months. The inauguration day, I mean foundation stone day to inauguration of the facility, 6 months exactly. So in that we had the rock. So I advised the architect to change the floor plan levels, floor levels in the plan. We have used the split level parking instead of underground parking. So even the footings we have planned on the rock itself. So sometimes the rock cutting dictates the planning. So that also we have to keep in mind. Parking above ground, thanks to NBC now, you need not go for every project basements. So better plan parking above the ground. But sometimes if you have poor soils in the top 10 meters level, let us say, it is advantageous to go for basement instead of piling. So that also we have to consider, and considering the water table and all. And micro piles on rock instead of footings, so that we can avoid rock cutting there also. And mining royalty, whenever we plan rock cutting or excavation nowadays, we have to plan the mining royalty. Please take that into account. 10% of your cost of excavation will go for mining royalty. So advise the clients on mining royalty, and then credit for excavated rock. This is another important thing, because the credit for excavated rock is whenever we give excavation rock cutting contract, we must keep in mind that rock can be reused. So we had seen in one contract, I don't mention the name, but the contractor was paid for rock cutting and disposal, and the contractor has used the same rock in the crusher and used for the concrete the same thing. So client has paid twice, one for disposal and the other for aggregate. So engineers have to plan in cost saving, because we can reuse the rock. So there is a credit for the cutting rock cut actually. So we have to mention that in the contract and take the credit for the clients. And deep excavation, whenever we have to go for shoring and strutting. And slope stability of the excavated line is to be considered. So sometimes when we have the space, we plan the slopes and berms, and when we don't have the space, we have to plan for the shoring. So different methods of shoring we have to discuss, and soil strata, water table to be investigated before planning excavation. So investigation also is required for excavation. Please don't think it is only for getting stair bearing capacity. We have to understand the type of soil, where it can be used, where it can be dumped, and what type of shoring strutting to be done. So based on the investigation only, we can take this decision. And there is always risk involved in deep excavation and cost involved in the deep excavation. So it requires a lot of value engineering while planning the deep excavation. So varying strata, that is whenever we go for deep excavation, there will be variations in the strata. That means different types of soils you encounter as you go deeper. So considering these variations, we have to take the proper decision which method of shoring strutting we can adopt, because we had the problems whenever there is a varying strata. So earthwork includes excavation, grading, that is moving earth to change the elevation, temporary shoring and backfill to or filling, adding earth to the raise the gradient, and compaction requires a proctor density test and disposal. So this is the earthwork. So classification of soils, we write in the contract all types of soils, including all types of soils, there is one rate. Why that? If you can estimate the nature of the soil properly, you can give different rates for different types of soils. Hard rock is different, soft rock is different, and you can plan in normal soils also, murram, hard murram, stiff clay, medium dense clay, loose sand, all will require different effort and it will cost different actually. So we have types of soil: sand, gravel, loamy clay, mud, black cotton soils, murram and shingle. So different types of soils we can mention. So these are all the ordinary rock you can see here. and we have very hard rock also, like granite or basalt kind of rocks also. So it's a limestone, sandstone, hard laterite, hard conglomerate, and the non-reinforced concrete. Sometimes we have to remove the concrete also. And in hard rock, we have quartzite, granite, basalt, different categories. And the rock boulders for which blasting is required. So sometimes we do the investigation with a borehole. We encounter the rock. We think it is a huge hard rock, but sometimes it ends up with a boulder only. So we have to have the clear investigation for identifying the actual nature of rock. So excavation is a man-made depression in earth surface formed by earth removal. So this is, so here you can see why I have put this photo is, this fellow is standing on the heap of earth, very risky actually, safety issue. That's why I took this photo to mention that it's not planned properly, excavation. You dump the earth and you stand on that earth to load the tippers. So this kind of things we have to avoid. And deep excavation, shoring methods, and any excavation that is deeper than 4.5 meters or 15 feet is treated as deep excavation as per the code. And then excavation without retaining system, then what are the slopes you can keep? And when you have mass excavation, here you can see the natural contour pillars left in the excavation, so that you can counter check the levels. Of course, I'll share the method statement for this kind of planning, the mass excavation. You should follow that. And deep excavation in soil or rock with some retaining system, usually in populated areas. We have to have the proper shoring strutting. You can see the mesh, you can see the gunneting and the pile, shoring pile, and this is the valor. Identification of soft or hard rock. So here I would like to see, you can see the video. When you can see the soil, it looks like a normal soil. But I had to then ask them to do the with this pocliner with shovel, so that we are sure how hard it is. So I spent some time to understand the nature of the rock and effort required to remove this kind of rock. So you can see. It looks so simple soil, but it is really hard. So next, I would like to show you different breakers. How so many breakers at a time. So it is a real challenge for the engineers to monitor this kind of breakers, how, what is going to happen. So much of rock, because here we are not allowed to do the blasting because there are buildings adjacent and work is going on. So we had to use only the breakers for breaking the rocks. So you can count how many breakers are there, 8 breakers simultaneously working. And this is the drilling of holes into the rock, whether it is for blasting. We drill the holes and then put the blast material. So safety is to be taken care really, and people get hurt in this kind of situation. And next is the blasting. You can see the control blasting happening here. This is a real control blasting. We have a building also adjacent. You can see. So blasting is done. So there is no noise and no vibration also. So next I would like to show you diamond rope cutting. Here in the rock, this is the diamond rope cutting. You can see it is like concrete, you know. We have cut this rock already using the diamond rope. And I'll share the costings of different methods. It's very important. So this is the machine, and you have a diamond rope, and you can cut the surfaces so perfectly. So there is no need for retaining wall also actually. You can put the waterproofing on this and have your building next to it. This is all cut rock, actually, you can see. So this is a method of diamond rope cutting. And then I would like to show you interesting thing, that is pulse plasma rock. This is a Korean technology. I'll speed it up. So we make the holes as it is, like we do for blasting only, and then we also put the cover for control, so that the stone will not be strewn, and put the weight on it. Oh, sorry, I'll just show you before. Yeah, now yeah, that's all. This is a high voltage of power is given, and then due to heat generated suddenly, the rock breaks like this. So this is the highest productivity with the least vibration, but the cost also will be higher. So you can get the small stones also. So this is, we have understood what are all the methods of cutting in the rock, and now excavation plans. This is another thing, engineers, you have to insist. If you are on site, you must insist from the consultant to issue the excavation plans, because there will be huge variation in the earthwork quantities if we don't make plan ourselves. The contractor will decide, otherwise at least mention that the excavation plans to be prepared by the contractor or staging of the earthwork and approved by the consultant, so that you are sure that and you can control the safety of the work. So here you can see there is a huge open deep excavation, 22 meters deep, and we have planned different methods, multi-level retaining wall. This is a drawing made, but we have not adopted this. It is a risky proposition. So here also you can see staging, excavation, how we excavate. First we'll excavate this here and form this retaining wall, and then backfill it. And then next level we'll excavate here up to here, and then backfill here, and then form the berm here again with this retaining wall. And next level we excavate up to here, backfill it. So this is the three level retaining wall. So this is one method we followed. We estimated, and another method is single retaining wall. That means you build the retaining wall here only by excavating and backfilling here. And then next third option is reinforced earth retaining wall. In fact, this worked out to be the cheapest, but client felt single retaining wall is a known method, but it costed very heavily. And next is the foundation excavation drawing. So we engineer, whenever we give the foundation layout drawing, so this is the footing, for example. So we cannot calculate the earthwork quantity with the footing size or PCC size alone. Sometimes adjacent footings will be close, and we have to draw this excavation line. So you can see this green is the excavation line, which is following the profile, so that our QS team can actually estimate the realistic earthwork quantity. That's very important. So here also you can see, when we have this retaining wall here, this is the cutting line. So you have to consider 1.2 meters and then follow the slope, and then this much of excavation we have to provide for. So the excavation line we have to give considering the type of soil. So that's very important point I wanted to share with you. So survey, it starts with the survey, joint measurement of the block levels. We have to mark the block plan and make sure that whatever layout is done can be achieved. Sometimes it happens after excavation, they start marking and it won't fit. It's very, so site clearance like this, bushes to be cleared and old structures to be removed, trees to be cut or translocated. So the prelude to excavation is we have to prepare the layout and excavation drawing. We have to phase the planning and method statement. Phase planning, that means phases of excavation and method statement for that. And we have to approve that method statement. Block marking to be done, and benchmark to be identified, permanent benchmark and reference grid pillars for the columns and excavation line. because many times we put the brick pillars and they go in the excavation itself. So that is a very important aspect we have to consider. And the joint grid levels to be recorded before excavation starts with the contractor, consultants and client's representative. And then grid pillars to be constructed, excavation lines to be marked on the site, and the contour pillars to be left. You have to identify at a grid interval of 10 meters or whatever is the measurement that is given in the code. We have to leave those contour pillars. So this is one of the excavation phasing plan. We have identified pocket wise. This is the full excavation area to be done. And here you can see P1, P2, P3. We have given the stages considering the adjacent building. So we never allowed total excavation because it will be exposed to, slope will be exposed to collapse risk actually. So we have planned, we have told the contractor this is the approved method. So this corner particularly is done at the end. And this building you have here close by. So we have done alternative pits to be done. You construct the retaining wall and then open the other alternative pits. So this is the cross section of that. So site grading next. So when you have a large area to be graded, you have to use the machinery to do the site grading and levels, form levels to be taken into account and embankment formations for roads and any other facilities required. And then a schedule of items in the earthwork. So this is the schedule I have taken from one of the contracts. How many items are there in earthwork? Surface dressing not exceeding 15 centimeters deep and getting out the loose or soft. This cannot be used actually because you will have the roots and grass in the top 15 centimeters. So we have to remove that. So it is based on the total area of the site plus minus buildings and drains area, roads area is deducted. And then removing excavated material exceeding 250 meters disposal distance, that is lead, but not exceeding 5 kilometers. Up to 5 kilometers, we give one rate, and beyond 5 kilometers, there will be a rate mentioned per kilometer. Excavation over areas not exceeding 1.5 meter depth. That means there is a rate up to 1.5 meter standard rate. And then spreading, leveling, and well ramming, including watering the morum, that is one item. And material and labor morum filling laid in layers not exceeding 15 centimeters in thick. We always write this in the specification, and the, when the contractor dumps whole earth in heaps, they say it is very difficult, and we had the discussion also. So when we have mentioned in the schedule 15 centimeter layers, why do we pay, when, why do we allow to be dumped and leveled in one go? Because it's a very bad work, and the quantity of earth also will be reduced, used for backfilling or filling. So spread, leveled and blinded with earth and rolled, including watering, and complete all as specified. This is the schedule specification. Excavation over areas, getting soft, loose soil, all as specified. And excavation over areas exceeding 1.5 meter and not exceeding 3 meters, getting hard or dense soil as specified. Returning, filling, return filling, that means reuse, refilling, including spreading, leveling, watering, and well ramming in layers not exceeding. This is when you have a large area, we use 25 centimeters also. When we use the rollers, we can go for 25 centimeters. If you don't use roller, you have to go for 15 centimeters. And removing excavated materials exceeding 1.5 kilometers, but not exceeding 5 kilometers. This is another. Grubbing up a tree trunk, that means we have to have a rate for removing the tree trunks also, and not exceeding 100 centimeters, and including cutting of trunk portion protruding over the ground, digging out roots and filling holes. And then formation of layers of gravel of size 63 mm and down, deposited spread and level layers not exceeding 15, if it is gravel filling. If it is morum filling, then 15 centimeters again, paving and rolled. Excavating over area exceeding 1.5 and soft loose soils, removing excavated material, and this is repeated, sorry. Scarifying or picking existing roads, if you have bitumen scarifying or concrete scarifying, we have to do so that we'll create the bond between the new layer and the old layer. So So these are all the different specifications we have to keep in mind. 8 tons roller for rolling, 8 tons and not exceeding 12 tons. We have to specify the roller depending on the loading that we are designing the pavement or flooring actually. So this is a mass deep excavation with the shoring piles or touch piles. You can see there is a varying strata which didn't work out well, and later we had to do the rectification of this. And this is the earth collapse that happens if we don't plan proper shoring system. And construction staging, you can see, while on one side excavation happens, on the other side we start the construction also. So here you can see excavation is happening, but at the same time we started the slab laying here. That can be done. And the marking of the mass excavation, the main challenge in earthwork is keeping track of the type of rock, whether it is a weathered rock, because there are different rates for weathered rock or hard rock. So we have to keep the record with like this marking, measurement, level and all that. And so that here you can see the levels are recorded by our engineer. 96 meters, 97 meters, and from 97 above is weathered rock. So we have marked the extent and depth up to which this rock is there. And here there is an instruction to the contractor to form the bump, proper bump, and fill up the gap. And use sites, you should be very careful while planning the excavation, considering the types of soil. So this is the phasing of, so you can see one building has raised, one phase of building has raised so many floors. Other phase we are still doing the excavation. And boulder stitching also is part of the earthwork. And then active anchors before stressing, we do the grout and wait for time to set and then do the stressing. And these are the anchor footings on the rock itself without cutting the rock. So you can see we use the rock anchors here. And water table, when you have the water, you can see the ladder here. We have to plan the concreting properly by dewatering. And here you can see we have planned the drains so that the water is collected into a pit and dewater from here and then do the work without, otherwise the water would have stayed here. And grid pillars, you can see here we mark the grid pillars for columns and excavation lines. And then excavation of isolated footing. So this is very difficult to use complete machine only. We have to do manual dressing after removing the main earth. And this is the large area of spreading, shoulder formations, and then excavation. This is a large area excavation and trench excavation, you can see here, and rock cutting using the expansive chemicals here. And this is also rock cutting for blasting. And here boulders, we do drill holes and make them small by using the expansive chemicals. And backfilling after casting of the foundations. And removal of boulders, you can see here expansive chemical is used by taking the measurement. We know the weight of the rock and then we plan the holes such that it will be broken into small pieces like this. So this is all rock cutting in stages. And blasting, use controlled blasting. This is also rock cutting by controlled blasting. So let us not leave it to the contractor to decide the method of blasting or the type of blasting. So we have to have clear understanding of the nature of the soil and plan the method of cutting. So here also you can see the boulders being cut. And this is manual splitting actually. And anchoring on the rocks, this is how you can see the footing is marked here on the boulder itself. And we put the anchors, this is the column and this is the footing, and footing concrete is cast on the boulder itself. We have not removed the boulder, we stitched the boulders. And here are the boulders and this is another footing. And this boulder is broken with what you call expansive chemical. And breaking of the boulders. And this is excavation for multi-level car park happening, different stages photographs. and mass excavation for foundation. Basements are there here, and it has mix of soils. We have the murram, we have the soft disintegrated rock or weathered rock. And this is the on the boulders, ramps to be formed. And this is a trench excavation. You can see the difference. This is for the compound wall trench and this is for the foundation trench. And this is also for the compound wall. Formation of roads, embankment. This is in a industrial site of 10 acres only. Even there we had to form the embankment to a height of 3 meters because the site level is varying too much, and considering the future expansion, they wanted the roads to be at the same level. So when they planned the future expansion, they will raise the plinth level later. We didn't do the entire site filling, but we formed the embankments for the roads considering the future level of the plinth. So this is the formation of roads by earth filling, and we have to plan the even the pitching with the natural slopes. Here we didn't use the RE walls because that worked out. So this is the pitching, stone pitching, you can see, and formation of culverts will be required whenever we form the embankment because water has to cross these embankments. And this is the excavation, huge excavation I have shown in the beginning, the retaining wall of 22 meters height. Retaining wall is constructed here on the hill slope. You can see the stages of excavation, very precarious condition of excavation, and it is a loose soil, but with a bearing capacity of 20 ton. And the PCC marking, dressing of the site, for otherwise if it is not dressed properly, the concrete volume will go up, but always for the contractor we pay. So we have to convince the contractor to spend little time on dressing the soil, even for putting the PCC. So here you can see the marking of the strata by the engineer. How after excavation, I asked our engineer to take the photograph of the excavated site and take the measurements of each strata, so that we are sure that, so you can see the calculation, how to estimate the percentage of soft disintegrated rock and percentage of hard rock. So this is a method. Here you can see we arrived at 63% soft rock, percentage of soft rock. We could calculate like this. So, and here it is 42% soft disintegrated rock. So we have taken the levels, and then each level, what is the percentage? Here it is zero soft rock, here it is 42%, and here it is 62% soft disintegrated rock. So overall weighted average we calculated, and we agreed with the contractor, and then paid based on this percentages only. So here you can see the soil type is verified by the engineer, and he will send us the photographs, and he will mark on the site also, take the photographs. So this is a method you can follow for monitoring the soft disintegrated rock as against the soil investigation report. So rock excavation by blasting and controlled blasting, and rock excavation by wherever there is a blasting prohibited, we can use the jack hammers, that is breaker method, and we can use the chemical fissures method, and we can use the excavator mounted hydraulic hammers and burner in the hard rock. This is apart from pulse plasma diamond rope cutting methods. So pulse plasma is the most efficient and latest technology that is available actually. We can drill holes up to 3 meters depth and insert plasma cells plug, that is electrical power, energized electro power impactor, and 30 kVA generator is enough. And we can break the rock up to 3 meters. This is the best method I feel. And if we start probably indigenizing and improvising, definitely the cost can be brought down. Otherwise today the pulse plasma cost works out to about 2,200 rupees per cubic meter. And diamond rope cutting may vary between 1,200 to 1,500 per cubic meter. And controlled blasting is 800 to 1,000 rupees. And uncontrolled blasting is 400 to 600. So this is the rates, you can make a note. So advantages, it is non-explosive, no vibration. Even if you have a building next to it, the low, very low vibration and low noise, low dust, no flying of rocks. Still, we do the we put the weight on top of the plus plasma area. And this is the noise levels recorded actually, depending on the depth of the excavation. Controlled powder blasting, you can see 0.575 centimeters per second vibration. And up to 20 meters, it comes to 1.8 centimeters per second. And EPA controlled blasting is 1/20th of it actually. So you can see it is 0.092 here. This is very low, so it is very advantageous. And noise levels also are given decibels. Here it is 83 decibels, very high, and whereas it is 67 decibels here. So controlled blasting and pulse plasma method, electrical power thing. So I have shared this with you. So temperature, controlled blasting, it is 169 degrees, and here it is 2850 degrees. And reaction temperature 1300 degrees here. Here it is 3000 degrees. So variation is not much here. This is the diamond rope cutting concept. Actually, you can get the blocks as it is. Actually, this concept has come from granite mining itself, where they make the mining slabs. So this diamond rope cutting is used. Rock breaking using chemicals, expansive chemicals. So here we drill the holes. There are real experts who will drill the holes in very weak planes and then put this expansive chemical, fill it, and overnight it expands, and next day morning you will get the rock broken into pieces like this. And royalty, this is the every state has got a mining department, and you have to take the no objection certificate from the mining department, otherwise you will end up paying penalties for not paying the royalty. It is always better to pay before. So this is the typical royalty thing. And equipments that we use for excavation is excavators, loaders, rippers, boring and tunneling jumbos, compacting graders, and finishing using rollers and drying, placing and dumping. So these are all the equipment. I'm just showing different types of equipment, and also I'll share a little bit of calculation about the productivity of these machines. So we have hydraulic excavators, backhoes, drag lines and clamshells, and telescopic boom hydraulic excavators, dozers, tractors, rippers and front end loaders. So these are the different equipment. So we have scrapers, trenchers, boring, tunneling. You can buy one this and have the different attachments also. That is also possible. And compaction equipment, we have rollers and tampers. And this is the hauling equipment for moving the earth. So tippers are main things. And here you can see the how to plan, what is the reach and all from the catalog you will get. And we have these clamshells also. And these are the excavation equipments and movers, earth movers and dozers. And we have this bobcat kind of small machines also. And we have JCBs, we have Percliners, L&T, Komats, earth moving equipment, and backhoes. So this is used for back shovel and pull shovel. And these are all the different types of earth moving equipment. Backhoe and dozer. And drag line, we have, this is a drag line, which you can move the, use it for loading, picking and loading the earth. And drag line applications are machine for dragging softer materials, and below the, it's a track level. So we can use this earth moving equipment. And a clamshell also we can use, this is the clamshell actually. So we can pick and drop the earth. And the scrappers we have, so these are the scrappers for leveling, for embankment formations and leveling, it can be used, this earth moving. And bulldozers, we all know, wheel mounted bulldozers and crawler mounted bulldozers, and cable controlled and hydraulically controlled. These are the bulldozers we use for earth moving actually. So different types of compaction equipment and trench cutting. You can see vibro earth rammer, and this is another plate vibrator kind of thing. And this is the sheep tooth, sheep foot roller. And so we have this crawler track drill model, and a spacing for bench drilling, and expected speed of drilling. And this is the we have a productivity of 45 cubic meters per hour, and this is 112 cubic meters, and this is 180 degrees fill factor, and we have dumpers of 25 ton payload capacity, and it can reach up to 120 cubic meters per hour, and we have 150 cubic meters per hour, so different 450 cubic meters per hour. So these are all the different earth moving equipment. So we should understand the costing of this machine and its capacity, so that we'll be able to, and utilization, of course. If we can never utilize 100% of the equipment. So normal average, I'll share that also, 50% is the utilization of this machinery. Here you can see the slopes to be planned. Compacted granular soils is 2:1, 63 degrees. So recommended slope for average soils is 45 degrees, that is 1:1. And compacted sharp sand is 1.5:1, that is 33 degrees. And well-rounded loose sand, 2:1, 2 horizontal, 1 vertical. Here, 1 horizontal, 2 vertical. 2 horizontal, 1 vertical. This is the variation. So you can plan, when you plan the drawing, depending on the soil, you can also give this kind of slopes. And then from source to compacted zone, how the earth volume varies. When it is natural soil, if it is 1 cubic yard or cubic meter, it becomes 1.25 cubic meters in loose condition, and after compaction it becomes 0.9 cubic meters. So this is the method estimation you have to consider for costing. Actually, dewatering, so we have to dewater. So we have to consider the dewatering required depending on the source of water table. And leads are not calculated below 50 meters, and above 50 meters, a multiple of 50 meters it is calculated. Lift, that is height up to 1.5 meters, no lift is taken. And beyond 1.5 meter, we calculate every 1.5 meter as one lift required costing. Sliding, sloughing, this is how it looks, the soil. If we don't plan proper shoring, this is how it can fail. And toppling, this means the collapse of the earth. And shoring required, different types of shoring. We have timber, hydraulic shoring, pneumatic shoring, and sheet pile, shoring piles, diaphragm wall, passive anchors, nailing or gunneting, and active anchors and gunneting. So these are all the system. So we have the normal natural slope shoring. And we have the shoring piles. This is 0.9 dia at 1 meter centering. And this is the drilling of holes for nailing. So this is after, while installing the soldiers. These are the soldiers, and we have the sandbags to be placed whenever there is urgency. And timber shoring, this is the timber shoring. And when you have the trenches, we use this hydraulic shoring. You can see this is the hydraulic machine which will induce the pressure so that the trenches won't collapse. And this pneumatic is same as hydraulic, but instead of hydraulic, it is pneumatic pressure. Soil nailing and components of soil nailing wall are grouted nails, and we drill the holes, grout the nails, and then put the mesh reinforcement, and we put the shotcrete or gunneting. And then grout mixing machine, this is the grout used for nails actually, or anchors. So steel reinforcement is used for nailing, and grout mix is used, and shotcrete or gunneting is done. So this is the construction sequence. As we excavate every 2 meters, we'll drill the holes and put the nail, grout it, and then put the mesh, and then after grouting, mesh is put and shotcrete is done. Then we'll go next level like this. So this is how the nailing is done. Otherwise, we have to have this kind of slopes and berms. And open basements is one concept I am using, where instead of building the retaining wall, you keep the natural soil slope with the nails or active anchors, and then you can get the natural light around instead of closing the basement. So this is the concept actually. This is the boundary wall. You have a slope 1 in 2.6, and because it is a soft disintegrated rock, and this is the last column of the building, and you will get this much of space, and you can even have the greenery on this slope. So this method also can be adopted for better light and ventilation. People will close this and use the forced air ventilation. Here you will get the natural ventilation. So this is the nails concept that we are using here. And this is the actual work being done. So these are the structural elements, beams and mullions kind of thing. And then we are putting the gunneting on top of it. So these are the valors. So this is about earthwork, rock cutting, and shoring, strutting and filling and backfilling. Now I can take the questions if you have any. Site preparation works. I have almost covered everything in this slide. If you have any further, you can ask me. I don't see any questions. Some network problem, even it's not showing sometime viewers. Okay. In the commercial places like malls, cinema halls, vastu, yeah, it depends on the client. IS 1200, yeah. How royalty is calculated? It depends on the type of the soil. It comes to almost 10% if it is a hard rock. Basement and government fixed charges. Per ton basis for entire area of the excavation. No, it is depends on the lead and type of the soil. Royalty charges. Yeah, soil and rock, different royalty is there. And 1 cubic meter, how many? 1.6 tons, yeah. I have shared in this. Backfilling is separate now. Quantity is calculated using. If blasting not permitted, what alternative? That I explained. We have breakers, we have the burners, and we have pulse plasma or diamond rope cutting. Diamond rope cutting is the least disturbance to neighbors actually. Use expensive chemicals. Output of machineries, I have shared that sample calculation. Every machine supplier will give the catalog with its capacity. So we can always estimate the cost depending on the operation, operating cost and capital cost, and considering the depreciation, we have to arrive at the rate. Rope cutting, yeah. Why can't we use expansive cement? Yeah, always expansive cement cannot be used because when it is a contiguous rock, it won't work. You have to open at one side and then use the expansive chemicals. I'm sharing the PDF. I'm trying to use any other method, but somehow I'm used to this system using the camera and screen. Please bear with me. Structural consultant will approve the excavation. Yeah, you have to get the approval from the structural consultant. Planning blasting is not suggestible due to government clearance. Yeah, that's right. Where we use this multi-level retaining wall. No, it is when it is very deep, like 20, 30 meters, use mass excavation, then we have to plan. That is one option we considered, but we didn't adopt multi-level retaining wall. Geotechnical and structural concern. Yeah, that's by using expansive cement, how time and site conditions affect. Excavation will be 1.5 meter around basement line. Might be your site in between developed in open area, we can use controlled blasting. Yeah, after doing vertical rope cutting, we are doing the controlled blasting. Yeah, that is also possible. Excavation, specification, removal of debris is considered. Before, first item is to remove the top layer of the soil. Mild control blasting with government permission. Yeah, that's right. Will be the criteria for maintaining side slope for deep excavation. I have given that slopes. It varies from 2:1 to 1:2 actually. For soils, it is 1:2. And while excavation, if any water prone pocket, then it has to be quantified as per actual measure. Yeah, we have in one site, what happened was we didn't expect the water, but it came. Then we monitored the number of hours of pump used, even diesel consumed and all. We arrived at the actual cost plus contractor's overheads and we paid. There is a huge variation between our costing and contractor claim. So it is always better to maintain the record of the consumables and machines used on site. Yeah, this is the first time I have used boulder stitching actually. I used the culture of rocks as a raft actually. Instead of removing the boulders and putting the concrete, I used the boulders as a concrete. It worked. We constructed a 7-story building on that. You have methodology for rock expansion, mortar, wire saw method, rock splitting. Yeah, we have. I have shown that the videos and it is costlier. Why straight retaining wall for 22 meters was considered? That is a client risk and cost approach actually. Client has decided he wanted a more reliable thing, system. And we did it actually without any problems. The project was completed, that itself. Explosives blasting, remembering my 30 years in. Yeah, Ideal is a company. Yes, KGK Gar. Pulse plasma can be used in city suburbs. Yeah, that's right. Good point. Reach is always considered. Yeah. Pulse plasma versus expansive chemical. No, we cannot compare these two. Expansive chemical, we use it for boulders kind of condition. For pocket excavation of footings, how much extra space? 1.2 meters all around. If we are not paying for shoring method. When we kept open basement about the rainwater, yeah, we have to drain to a collection pit and pump it out. Basement parking and podium parking. Yeah, that has to be worked out case to case actually. We cannot give a blanket decision depending on the soil condition and actual building height. Thank you, Subhash. Open basement, which type of building we can go for? Open basement. I didn't understand Rakesh Kumarji. Ring bunds, yeah. I didn't add that photograph. In fact, in the last minute, I added that point because I had to cover all the. Yeah, coffer dam is used in dam projects. So if you see about Polavaram, if you type, you'll get a lot of information about coffer dam. Output per day in mass rock excavation. 30 cubic meters is a very good output actually. That's why I said we spent 1 year for 1 lakh cubic meters. Thank you, Mahesh. Thank you. Which are the explosive chemicals? I don't remember the names. How to plan the column fixing same level in case of rocks? That's a real tough challenge. It's better to use the natural profile and use the anchors. Vastu for residential building. Pulse plasma versus expansive. There are always dispute regarding identifying soft and hard rock. Yeah, that's right. That's why I've shown the video also. We have to take the sample, test it. Compressive strength, depending on the compressive strength, you can decide. what holes distance chemical blasting, that depends. Actually, these workers are more experts for fixing the holes. With experience only you will know. Opening basement, if you don't provide retaining, slope area can't be used. No, we can put the greenery on the slope area. Excavation for pillars in river, which procedure? In fact, river beds are all loose actually. We form the ring bund first and then start excavating as usual. Thank you, Ashok Sharma ji. Repeat the rates for different rock cuttings. Yeah, 400 to 600 for uncontrolled blasting, controlled blasting 800 to 1000, diamond rope cutting 1200 to 1500, and pulse plasma 2200 to 2500. This all depends on the rock and disposal lead and all that, including the disposal. And you have to take credit for the rock, depending on the type of the rock. If you come across big voids to a depth of, what can be done? Why is straight retaining wall considered in spite of costlier? Repeat, sir, world highest railway bridge is in Jammu and Kashmir, and it's especially, is it the best slope construction? Hampers natural structure, yes. We have to avoid the blasting near existing structure. How will we be able to calculate the quantity of various strata that I have shared? Strutting, please explain. Strutting means to the shoring, this is shoring, and the strut is support. Different rate for removing soft rock and hard rock, yes. What is the design method for gable wall? Measurement problems coming in between client and cutting contractor while cutting boulders. Yeah, you have to, that's why follow proper method of measurement. Soil is BC, to what depth we can excavate for cellar? We have gone even up to 12 meters depth in cellars, yeah. In fact, 50 by 100 means it doesn't qualify for cellar, in fact. Better to restrict to one basement only. For 50 by 100. There are always disputes regarding identifying soft and compared to blasting, plasma method is better always. Epoxy based, not epoxy, it is expensive chemical. So thank you very much. We'll meet again on Monday, next class, that is on water supply, Monday. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Have a good weekend. Bye. See you.